Right, today we are going to perform two more experiments as they are based they are related to the single kit. So today we are going to perform two more experiments. One is PCM analog to digital conversion, and it is not justifiable to name it as analog to digital conversion. I'll tell you why, but in your course curriculum it is mentioned as analog to digital conversion, okay? And another experiment is time division multiplexing. So we are going to illustrate both of them. So we are using this same kit for both of the experiments. So in your course curriculum, these two are mentioned as two other experiments and named as or the heading mentions two other experiments. But we are performing it on a same kit, so we are going to perform it on the same day. So today we will be completing total of 9 experiments till now. So one experiment will be left that we are going to perform on the coming turn. So whole 10 experiment will be completed hopefully on the next turn. Okay, so today we are going to perform, as I told all of you on the previous turn, we were talking about pulse modulation, right? And I was telling all of you that in case of pulse modulation, we are having two types of modulation, either analog pulse analog modulation, or the second case was pulse digital modulation. So I was trying to explain all of you that in pulse analog modulation, we don't send a whole of the information, all the instantaneous value of a signal. If there is a sinusoidal signal or any kind of signal we are having as a message signal, so we don't send the whole information of the signal, but some sampled values of the signals. And I was also attaching the clause of that we need to take sufficient number of samples when we are sending that particular signal. But I was also trying to tell you the difference between pulse analog as well as the pulse digital modulation. And I was trying to infer that in case of pulse analog modulation, the amplitude of the message signal can be any. It can be any real values. It can be as high as any big values, or as low as any lesser values, or it can be negative also. It can be positive also, right? But when it comes to pulse digital modulation, it means that the value of amplitude of our message signal is also divided into some quantized levels. And each quantized level, whenever the sample falls in between that quantized level, accordingly we decide that that particular coding of that particular amplitude value is done. So the quantized levels are there. So the whole amplitude values, the range of the amplitude of our message signal is also divided into some quantized levels, and each quantized level is encoded by some code using some technique we use to code that. That's why it is also named as pulse code modulation technique. So there is a pulse signal as our carrier signal, and it is a pulse modulation, right? But the amplitude is divided into some quantized levels, and each quantized level is coded into some 0 and 1s in form of 0s and 1s. It means that there is some coding. So pulse code modulation. So it comes, the name also says that it is pulse code modulation. So here the amplitude level is also coded. That much we have understood. One of the benefit of pulse code modulation is that you are sending the whole data, whatever be the information you are having, any sinusoidal signal or any kind of information. As I am speaking, I am delivering some information, right? But the whole information is transformed into a string of zeros and ones. It means that either we are sending 0 volt or we are sending some positive 5 volt, right? So if you know that you are sending only two type of data, either 0 or 1, the whole string of 0 and 1, in case if any noise gets added up in between, then also the 0 will become little bit of 1 volt or 1.5 volt or 2 volt. And if the particular higher level, the 5 volt for 1 is getting increased or decreased, then also the distortion in the shape of the that particular 0 and 1 signal can be detected, that what was it was originally what was the nature of the signal, either 0 or 1. So in PCM system, one of the beauty of the PCM system is that we can use regenerators and repeaters in between. Let's consider if we have to communicate to a distance of 1,000 kilometers, then in between at the distance of 100 or 200 kilometers, you can have a transceivers. They are called as transceivers because they are having transmitter as well as receiver at their part, and they are also called as regenerators. They receive the data, they regenerate it, because regeneration is easy. As I told all of you that there is only two type of data, either we are sending 5 volt or 0 volt, and there is a huge string or long string of the data, because all the information is getting converted into zeros and one at the transmitter part only. So that regenerators and repeaters, also called as transceivers, receive that signal. They correct those the distortions that we have got in between this 0 to 200 kilometers or 100 kilometers, and they again regenerate the data and send that data using the transmitting antenna to transmit it. So in PCM systems, we can have this possibility of regenerators and repeaters. So these systems are more reliable, and we get exactly the same data with minimal noise intervention in this case. And they can be retrieved at the receiver with more accuracy and with more correctness. Okay, so you can easily say that this PCM. So what we are going to perform in this experiment, whatever experiment we are going to perform, we are having multiple sources. So there comes, if multiple sources wants to transmit information through a common channel, when I'm saying channel, then you can consider channel as a wired medium also. You can consider channel as this atmosphere, the air is a medium to transmit the signals, or any other medium that you want to infer. So this medium of transmission is called a channel. So if multiple sources want to put the information, and we want to take samples or take information from multiple sources and include all of them, code them all into a single string of information, and then send it to the using a transmitting antenna to the environment, and at the receiver part it is being segregated, whatever the information channel the source one was sending, whatever the information source two was sending. So multiple person, I usually give an example of, if you consider there are five speakers sitting on the stage, and one by one every speaker is going to speak on the podium. If we allow all of the speaker to speak at once, everybody is speaking, then the audience won't decipher which speaker is saying what. The same technique is used in this communication system. We allow each source to transmit the data at a time, then again the slot is given to the another source that then it transmits its data, and that data, all the data from all the sources are getting clubbed and converted into zeros and ones, coded through PCM. Any of the technique can be used to code these data, and the whole data is clubbed into a PCM data, and again we send it from the transmitter to in form of one and zero, a string of zeros and ones. This is the whole idea behind this PCM system, but here we are illustrating this multiplexing techniques. So we are having PCM TDM systems here. So here we have taken two DC signals as a sources. Two sources we have taken. So we can take any kind of source, any number of sources also, and we can also take any number of any kind of sources. We can have a sinusoidal signal at source one, and can have sinusoidal signal at source two also. But in order to reduce the complexity of the system, because we are going to change the values of these input signals and see what are the changes we are observing at the final PCM output that we are getting here at the transmitter one. So this is our first experiment. As I told all of you that we are going to perform two experiments today. So this is our first experiment in which we are going to change the value of one of the input signal that we are giving. We are having two sources. So as I told all of you that for simplicity, we have considered both of the sources as DC sources. We can have sinusoidal signals also. But when we are taking DC voltages, then we can use multimeters and measure the voltage or change the voltage. So there will be simplicity. But when we are using this AC, any time domain signal of AC variation signal, or you can say continuous waveform, then we need to use two DSOs to see the variation and other things. So in order to reduce the complexity, but what I'm trying to say is these two sources can be anything. When I'm saying can be anything, any kind of signal it can be. Okay, so we are taking the samples, we are taking the information from the first, then again taking the information from the second. So there is a circuit that decides how much time we are taking the input from the source one and how much time we are taking the input from the source two. It means there is some switch that is going to switch from source one to source two. That whenever we are taking data from source one, as I if there are two persons and they are allowed to speak one sentence, they have to decipher one paragraph. Both of the speaker have to decipher one paragraph, and that particular information should be shared with the audiences, whosoever is present. So once we allow both of the speakers, you just speak your one first line, and then you will stop. The other speaker will speak his first line or her first line. Then the again slot will be given to the first speaker to decipher his or her second line. Again, second line to the second speaker, then again third line to the first speaker, and then again third line to the second speaker. In this way, we are having a timing logic when we are allowing one speaker to provide the information or to transmit the information for some time period, and again the slot is given to the second speaker. So it can be decided by using a timing circuit or timing logic. Once I'll share the link, you will see the kit, you will see the timing logic circuit there. So we are taking inputs from this first source and second source. We are having these two sources, -5 volt to +5 volt variation. We are having a knob that we can turn it right to get from -5 to +5 volt of this DC voltage. As I told all of you that we are taking two sources and we are taking DC sources. We could have taken any other source also. There are some sources, sinusoidal sources also present there, but for simplicity we have taken these DC sources. Okay, so keeping one of the source constant, we are changing the other source, the value by 1 volt. So from -5 volt to -4, -3, -2, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we are changing voltage of one of the source and see what is the final PCM output that we are getting. It means that we are going to get the voltage in terms of zeros and ones. So how we are going to indicate these zeros and ones? We are having a system in which we are having LEDs attached to the kit, so that if LED is glowing, so we can say there is one. If not glowing, then there is zero. So we can code this whole PCM output, taking the inputs from two sources, multiple sources, multiplexing them both, and getting the final PCM output, right? In terms of ones and zeros. So we are clubbing these two outputs, the inputs of these two sources, and getting the common string or the whole string that we are going to transmit using a transmitting antenna for the TCM system, right? So this particular thing they have named as the one who has designed your course, this curriculum, they named it as analog to digital conversion. Why I usually say that this is not the correct name for this analog to digital conversion? Because it is not an analog to digital conversion. It is something multiplexing of two source data that we are getting from two sources. We are multiplexing them and we are coding them into PCM output, and we are indicating them what is the final PCM output. So you can say that it is a multiplexed PCM coded data for two these sources, +5 volt, -5 volt, or any changes you are making, right? But it can't be analog to digital conversion, but they have named it such way, so it is like that only. So what I'm trying to say here is, the first experiment says we are going to plot these two things. We are taking inputs from two sources, -5 volt, -5 volt. Again, we are going to change one of them, keeping other constant. So one of them will be at -5 volt, other will, we are going to change, and we are going to notice what is the string that we are getting as a PCM output in form of zeros and ones. So we are having LEDs from D0 to D6 indicated as D0 to D6. There are 7 bits of these LEDs, and 7 LEDs are there. So accordingly, which one is glowing, which one is off, accordingly we can prepare the table. So that they call it as analog to digital conversion, but I don't call it as analog to digital conversion. But you will also understand why we can't call it as analog to digital conversion, because it is not analog to digital conversion. Okay, so we are clubbing the inputs from two sources, and we are looking at this multiplexed output, PCM coded multiplexed output, right? So this is our first experiment in the name or the in the heading of analog to digital conversion. Second experiment that we are going to perform today is this particular multiplexed output, when it is transmitted and it is received at the receiver. There is a receiver kit, another kit that is placed there So we can connect these two kits. We assume that whatever we are transmitting from the transmitter, we are receiving at the receiver. So we can connect both of them. There are some connections. As you will watch the video, you will come to know that there is coherent detection. Whenever we are seeing coherent detection, it means that clock information at the both of the transmitter and receiver should be same, or you can say same for both the cases. So we can say that the clock that we are using at the transmitter kit or at the transmitter kit must be same as the clock that we are going to use at the receiver kit. So as we are having this both of the kits available at the same place, so we have facility to connect both of the clocks and make it common. But in real scenario, when this communication is going to take place, then we are going to send clock information from transmitter to the receiver in terms of some bits, so that receiver can detect that this is the information for clock and can generate the same clock over there, right? So we can send the information of the clock. Second thing, whenever we are communicating, whenever I'm saying if somebody is joining this class right now, so some of the messages is already lost because I'm speaking from 15 to 20 minutes. So it means that the string, whenever information, whenever someone is saying something, the initial of the sentence must be perceived as initial of the sentence at the receiver. It means there must be some synchronization between these two, right? So there is synchronization must be there. It means that whatever be the start of some information must be taken or perceived as a start of the information at receiver end. If somebody is detecting it at the middle part, if I'm speaking a sentence and if you are start listening from the middle part, then you won't decipher the exact information. It means that whatever be the initial of the information must be taken as initial of the information at the receiver part. So there must be some synchronization. So we are having pins for synchronization. So we have synchronized both the transmitter and receiver. So this is a connection, as well as so as we are using these DC voltages. So both ground must be same for the transmitter and receiver. It means that the reference point that we are taking in order to measure a positive voltage or negative voltage must be same in both the cases. So we have connected these two also. So these connections you will understand once you will watch the video. So what we are trying to do by this second experiment, we are transmitting the signal, the PCM signal, that is multiplexed PCM output of the signal, that is the data taken from both the sources, multiplexed into one, converted into strings of zeros and ones, and there again there are some error check detection bits also. We can detect or check the error. We can include some parity bits there. You must have read about all this in digital electronics also, that we are having some methods using which we can check even parity, odd parity, and other error detecting techniques are there. So there are blocks for that. Then we are having this parallel to serial converter, because we are going to send the data from the transmitter serially in form of zeros and ones. So there must be some conversion mechanism. So you know that shift register can do this purpose for us. So we have this shift register to shift this parallel data into serial data. So we'll get a string of zeros and ones at the transmitter. So this particular string of zeros and ones is containing information that is clubbed from both the sources, either one be minus 5 volt, other be minus 5 volt also, other can be minus 4 volt, minus 3 volt, whatever be the information. It means that the whole information of both the signals is getting clubbed into one and converted into a string of zeros and ones. And this string is getting transmitted to the receiver, and the receiver again can separate and segregate these two and can receive what was the information the transmitter trying to send from source one, what was the information sent by the source one, and what was the information sent by the source two. So we can segregate these. So you can say that we have multiplexed the information at the transmitter part, and we have demultiplexed the information at the receiver part. Okay, so this is something like PCM TDM system. So we are using PCM pulse code modulation technique to perform all these things, but we are using time division multiplexing. Why we are saying time division multiplexing? Because we are allotting time slot for first source to transmit the information and again the second source to transmit the information. So there is a timing circuit. There can be other techniques also. You must have heard about frequency division multiplexing or code division multiplexes. There are so many techniques of multiplexing. present, but here we are using time division multiplexing. So we have performed time division multiplexing using PCM technique. We are transmitting the data. So that's why the name came, the PCM TDM system. Okay. So here we are multiplexing the data at the transmitter and we are demultiplexing the data at the receiver, and we can segregate both the information from source one and source two. So whatever information we were sending from the source one, either it be -5 volt, we should get at least close to -5 volt at the source one, or the output of the source one at the receiver, and accordingly for the source two at the receiver, because we are having two sources here at the transmitter and at the receiver. Okay, so if you have any confusion, then you can ask. I'm going to share the link here in the chat box. You can click on the link and you can watch the video. You can complete the video. I hope it will be of 35 minutes. I think so. It will be not more than 35 minutes. So you just complete the video. We are going to meet at 3:15. I think 3:15 will be okay. Okay, 3:20. 3:20 we are going to meet. Yes? Complete the video. 3:40. Yes? Yes, Rahman, do you want to say?
3:40.
Is the link working fine? Anyone inform me?
3:40 will be
best. What?
3:40 will be best, sir.
3:40? Okay. Then I'll take the attendance at that time only. So complete the experiment till that time. Okay, 3:40. That's okay. Complete the experiment, and if you are having any confusion, then you can ask in between. Also, you can note it down. We will discuss when we meet at 3:40. Also, okay.
Sir, I want to ask a favor, sir. Our exam is from the next week, sir. Can you please have only one experiment today?
So I didn't get you. What you were trying to say?
Sir, aaj se ek experiment ho sakta hai.
See,
our exam next week.
Okay, no problem. You just watch it till I think the one experiment will be of I think 15 minutes or 10 to 15 minutes will be sufficient for one experiment. So you watch one part of this video at least 15 or 20 minutes, and we will conduct the other one. The same link will be there for you. Save the link somewhere so that you can watch it till the next turn. We'll take one more turn to complete this experiment. We have sufficient time because today, if we complete these two experiments, then the number will become 9 experiments will be done. Okay, so we'll take one more turn to complete this experiment. No issues. Just watch the first part of this particular thing so that you can understand this analog to digital conversion thing at least. And the other part you will watch when you get time. But I'll share the same link again on the next turn. Okay, so that you can watch the second part of the video, and we will consider that as a TDM PCM or transmission of that particular thing is done. Okay, is it okay, Rahman? That will fine.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir.
Okay.